You'll be happy to know that I won't be speaking Danish tonight. I think you're in for about 30 or 35 minutes of lecturing. And my talk is an attempt, quite simply, at a reading of Falstrom's work and early life from the point of view of the exhibition Manipulating the World, as well as from my own recent curatorial experience with his work. Now, Manipulating the World, that's curated by Fredrik with the artist duo Goldin and Sendeby, takes its title from a 1964 article by Falstrom, in which he talks about his work as picture machines in which you can manipulate the world. In his curatorial statement, Fredrik writes about the exhibition, quote, "We approach manipulation as a means to produce interfere, intervene, disrupt, and question reality in all its forms." On his side, during his career, Falstrom developed a variety of artistic means with which he exercised the right and the power or counterpower to manipulate symbolic worlds. These were his refusal of remaining within any single media or genre, practice or style, all his games, and his providing the conditions for inviting the viewer into an artistic space structured by performativity and event. Falstrom worked with art on a global scale and on what can be called a civic scale too, creating theatrical plateaus such as World Bank, a work that Kim West, another colleague of mine here in Stockholm, has recently characterized as, quote, "a drama of exploitation, oppression, and conflict." Parenthetically, as an aside to World Bank, I should say that Sharon Avery Falstrom, who was married to Falstrom, told me to mention that the actual World Bank has just decided to end financial support for oil and gas exploration, which is certainly good news, and as Sharon puts it, Øyvind would welcome this change of policy. I should also mention that much of the biographical information that I'll be quoting in the following has been provided to me by Sharon, and that she and I are piecing together Falstrom's Brazilian childhood years. Now, it seems clear that Falstrom saw art as a global asset, to put it that way. It may seem counterintuitive then to introduce his biography into a discussion of how his art was worldly and how he worlded art. Surely the trajectory of his life is a small element in all of this, but it's also with the smallest elements that we should begin, to quote his manifesto from Concrete, his manifesto for Concrete Poetry from 1954. We can take it from the horse's own mouth and quote the artist from a questionnaire that he was asked to fill out by the MoMA when they acquired the collage Eddie, Sylvie's brother, in the desert in 1968. They ask in the questionnaire, and this was a questionnaire that all artists whose work they acquired at the museum was given. What in your ancestry, nationality, or background do you consider relevant to an understanding of your art? And Falstrom replies, "Swedish and Norwegian parents. First 10 years spent in Brazil, frequent stays in France, Italy, 1955 to 60, stay in New York, 1961 and onwards, activity as writer, poetry, prose, reviews, essays in Swedish, theater happenings such as Jean-Jacques Lebel, happening Paris 1966, Concrete Poetry, Something Else Press." As you already no doubt know, Falstrom was born in Brazil to Scandinavian parents, and he spent his childhood in Sao Paulo and Rio de Janeiro. His parents sent him to Stockholm to visit family in July of 1939. World War II broke out September 1st, and he couldn't return home. He saw his parents again in Stockholm in 1948. This is Falstrom's cover illustration from 1962 for the Danish poet Ivan Malinowski's translation of 15 modernist poets. It's a work that surfaced last year at Museum Jorn in Silkeborg in Denmark. The museum were not aware that they owned the Falstrøm in their collections. And the work is a game board depicting a car race in a tropical setting, into which Falstrøm has intervened graphically with character signs from his sitting series. If we build maps of reality to manipulate them, our biographies too are subjective cartographies to be made and remade in order to make sense. This is not least true for Falstrøm, who suffered the strange and paradoxical fate of being exiled to the region of his paternal and maternal culture. His being born an expat was exacerbated by his living a displaced existence from a young age, far from his parents, school, and football friends. It's a truism about modern art that it was created in exile, and also in Falstrøm's work, the sense of the world is not a foundational narrative. The world is a gap or even an abyss. As he was moved from one culture to a quite different one as a child, and hence could see where one world ended and another one began, he lived across their limits at the same time as he had to accept the way that worlds squeeze and knead the individual subject. To connect Øyvind Falstrøm was also a concern to himself regarding how he could piece together a map of his subjectivity and how he could authentically model his world against the backdrop of the lack of a definite and manageable order. Artistically speaking, Falstrøm's restlessness was exemplary. It would be one-dimensional, of course, to reduce this to an autobiographical matter. And in general, to discuss Falstrøm's biography at all is controversial among some art historians. For instance, the Brazilian art historian Sergio Bessa derides the idea that we could get something from a biographical reading of Falstrøm. I agree that we should not give primacy to biography. This is tendentious, and it would also run counter to Falstrøm's Catholic taste and his polymorphous sense of the world. Even though he was sui generis, even though he was unique in what he did, and even though his hand is always present in his work, whether as an inventive manipulator, as an image jockey, as a plotter or sequencer, or as a versioner, his personal life is never subject matter or content. There's no essential subject behind his work, but nor is anything excluded from it. It's also true that his life trajectory is one text, among others, that bears witness to his work. To Falstrøm, taking care of the world implied using life material, as he writes somewhere. You could say that Falstrøm made homelessness productive by embedding it in a refusal to make an artistic medium his own. Instead, he availed himself to all media and invented his own too. Variable structures, such as Dr. Schweitzer, in which the image elements could be recombined and sequenced. Or he built a new space for painting, such as Garden, a world model, where journalistic and statistical maps, shaped as tropical fish or exotic plants, and conveying information about a toxic world order, hover on sticks in flower pots. Beyond the exposé of the state of the world anno 1973, Falstrøm described Garden as a dream image of a childhood memory of a Brazilian garden. As a cognitive cartography and a dream of childhood memory, the installation combines political and existential planes in a new artistic language that allows for their coexistence. To add another layer to this from a Moderne Museet perspective, the formal inspiration to Garden came from Matisse's Apollo from 1953 that was purchased for the collection in 1968, so we can guess that Falstrøm would have seen Matisse's work here at Moderne Museet. Falstrøm's work had a mediumistic complexity, and I use the term mediumistic in the full spiritualist sense of the term, as when a spirit medium channels a radically different world. In Falstrom's case, this channeling played out between text and image, sound and vision, sense and nonsense, self and non-self, past and present, art and politics, Sao Paulo, Stockholm, New York, and so on. In this play, the freedom of art remains vexed and irritated, you could say. Falstrom gives the viewer the means to shift from where he or she is, or he or she should be, to go to an elsewhere, to some other condition or another symbolic constellation. He never offers utopia, though. His work doesn't promise a new human being or art's oblation into life. His work knows art as uninhabitable. This is a formative insight for concrete poetry, an art form that refuses the normative and metaphysical power of language. Falstrom has been credited as the first to use the term concrete poetry in his 1954 text, Hippie Pappy Birthday to the Thither. I think he would want us to pronounce it Manifesto for Concrete Poetry, which borrows its title from A.A. Milne's Winnie the Pooh. Apropos of biographical narratives, it's a strange coincidence that my grandfather worked in Brazil for a branch of the same Danish company that Falstrom's father represented in Rio de Janeiro and Sao Paulo, namely Portland Cement, which was a producer of cement, of concrete, and a builder of concrete factories. We have an ad here from Correio Paulistano, 1922, where it says, Cimento Portlandi, Dinamark Hest de Procedencia di Olborgi, so Danish from Aalborg, which is a good thing, supposedly. And Sao Paulo, the city of Sao Paulo today, is this never-ending, still-expanding, concrete megapolis, which is very different from the city it would have been in young Falstrom's days almost 100 years ago, when it was a fraction of its current size. But it remains the fact that concrete is the material par excellence of Brazilian modernity, seeing that not only cities such as Sao Paulo were cast in concrete, but also the country's new capital, Brasilia, was built entirely in this material. So thanks to his father's job, Falstrom had a very literal connection to concrete. Portuguese is a very concretist language too, if you will. Something that as a child fascinated me when my mother told me about my grandfather's Brazilian adventures was this wavy accent that puts the ao into sao, as in Sao Paulo. So Portuguese is a language with a wow sound. In 1959, Falstrom participated as one of Sweden's two official artists to the fifth Sao Paulo Biennial with the painting Arte Lediggende II from 1955, which won honorable mention at the Biennial that year. On this occasion, his work was summarized as it said in the catalog, mais ou menos surrealista, so more or less surrealist. And it was noted in the catalog that, quote, Falstrom fills his paintings with magic and suggestive signs such as Egyptian hieroglyphs or the symbols of Aztec writing, unquote. In his own words, with Arte Lediggende, Falstrom set out to create a world of situations and actions in a contradictory, discontinuous time space, unquote. The art historian Jesper Olsson evokes the series of paintings as Falstrom's construction of a, what he calls, quote, peculiar world, a kind of merging of the fantasies of Jorge Luis Borges and William S. Burroughs with Hieronymus Bosch as art historical switchboard, unquote. Now, to understand Falstrom's magic and suggestive signs, it's crucial to know that he was a concrete poet as much as he was a surrealist. In Mary Ellen Salt's definition, the material of the concrete poem is language itself, words reduced to their elements of letters to see or and syllables to hear. It is in her wonderful book, Concrete Poetry, A Worldview from 1968, that Mary Ellen Solt credits Fahlström as the first artist and poet to use the term concrete poetry. I can really recommend to look into this. It's a watershed publication. Now, concrete poetry binds Fahlström directly to Brazilian culture. He said that had he not been sent away, he would probably have been a Brazilian concrete poet. He later discovered, thanks to Solt's pioneering book, that he'd been working in parallel with the influential Neugandres group of concrete poets. This was a very influential Brazilian group of concrete poets that included artists such as the brothers de Campos, and as well as Decio Pignatari. But there were major differences between Fahlström and the Brazilian concrete poets. The Brazilians, who created visual poems meant to be seen, like painting, were inspired by architecture for their project to modernize language, for their project to modernize Portuguese. Fahlström's point of departure, on the other hand, was the composer Pierre Schaeffer's concrete music. And Fahlström created sound poems meant to be heard like music. The art historian Sergio Bessa writes, quote, if the concrete poetry of the Neugandres group aimed at tearing down the Portuguese language, Fahlström worked in an opposite direction to make the Swedish language more complex, unquote. On several occasions, apparently, Fahlström was invited back to exhibit at the São Paulo Biennial, but he declined the invitation every time it was issued following the military coup in 1964. I believe this was the case too in 1968 for the 10th Biennial that took place at a time when the dictatorship had taken a turn for the worse, and countries such as France, Netherlands, and Sweden boycotted, along with many individual artists. And it is almost not too late to talk about last year's São Paulo Biennial, of which I was a co-curator. At this Biennial, we presented a number of works by Fahlström connected to a genealogy of his concrete poetry. And in relation to the biennial's title of, in Portuguese, Incerteza Viva, which translates to English as something such as live uncertainty or live uncertainty or long live uncertainty. This title was a leitmotif that embraced uncertainty and unknowing, you could say, as cultural conditions, as a way to open up the exhibition to social realities surrounding it. My co-curators for the biennial were Gabi Nobo, Sofia Olascuaga, Julia Rebusas, and Jochen Fols. And our co-curator for the Fahlström presentation was, again, Sharon Avery Fahlström. Now, since 2004, the São Paulo Biennial has been free of access to everybody, so which makes a big difference in a place like Brazil. And it also helps create sort of quite large audience numbers to the exhibition. There's also, because of this, there's also a very extensive educational program for school children and youngsters. So as part of the preparations for the biennial, there's this big team of mediators, of educators, who are trained and who sort of become experts in the exhibition in order to convey it to children, to youngsters who visit the biennial. And when I gave a talk about Fahlström, among other artists, at the Biennial, one of the mediators asked me, so had he been alive today, would Fahlström have boycotted again? Which was a good question. Now, the situation was that last year's Biennial took place in a situation of major political upheaval. 6 months before the opening of the Biennial, the former president, Dilma Rousseffi, was impeached, and she was finally kicked out of office in what I would say amounts to something like a coup d'etat or sort of an administrative type coup. And she was followed by the present president Temer, who is then an unelected president. So this was something that happened during the preparations of the biennial. You could say that we the biennial received a couple of presidential gifts on this occasion. One was that the fact is that just a week before the exhibition opened, it was finally a done deal that Dilma was no longer a president in Brazil. The new president, Temer, opened his new term saying at a press conference, "So now uncertainty is finally over." Then it was great to be able to open this exhibition and say, "Well, no, it's not over, it's just begun." Also, the president's wife, who is some 60 years younger than himself, visited the exhibition, and she told the press that she was disgusted by the work of Carla Felipe, a Portuguese artist, who made an installation just outside the Biennial Pavilion in some large, industrial size wheels of heavy machines. And she said that, well, you know, now we just got rid of burning tires in the streets, and then you see them again at the exhibition at the Biennial. What is this? So, no, so uncertainty was not over and done with. Den svåra resan, or The Difficult Journey, is a sound piece that Fahlström created in 1954, the same year that the Biennial Pavilion was built. And there is something quite sort of cinematic in both Fahlström's sound piece and the way in which the window units in Oscar Niemeyer's pavilion look like so many strips of celluloid film. A concrete poem performed by a choir, Den svåra resan comes across as a soundtrack for a science fiction movie. A drinking song performed by an inebriated party very late at night. Or it's the melancholic sound of somebody who lives with the certainty of being far from home, but doesn't know where home is. It's also a great Scandinavian sound piece to show abroad because it only has a few recognizable words of Swedish left in it. Otherwise, it consists of sound words of onomatopoeia and almost completely dissolved language matter. In the mid-60s, Fahlström had extended variability from paintings to a three-dimensional structure in the installation Sitting Blocks. The vocabulary of character signs Fahlström developed for the Sitting series refers to Batman, among other sources, the masked Avenger fighting corruption in Gotham City. Fahlström's presence at the Sao Paulo Biennial last year also owes something to the collaboration of our artistic director Jochen Fols with Daniel Birnbaum at another biennial, namely the 2009 Venice Biennial, that Jochen and Daniel co-curated, and where the installation of Dr. Schweitzer was also presented. Apropos of this Venice Biennial's theme of making worlds, Daniel wrote in his catalog text something that could be applied to Fahlström's works, considered as zones of activity or even as escape vehicles. Daniel wrote, quote, "Can each artwork be a principle of hope and an intriguing plan for escape?" Unquote. If we think of the child who shuttled between three or four languages, English and Portuguese at school, Norwegian and Swedish at home, the notion of manipulation becomes a matter of navigating and recomposing, of recognizing patterns on an everyday level. Manipulation also becomes a question of pulling one's multiple selves together as so many energies and determinants that make for the vibrant matter of subjectivity. such an assemblage of elements is aimed towards an event and not origin or essence, in that it generates properties that are emergent in their ability to make something happen, which is very much like a work by Fahlström. So, I mean, the idea with sitting blocks was that, in principle, the viewer could engage in an active relationship with these building blocks, with the pictorial elements, which in this case are three-dimensional sculptural elements. So you could, you know, build a new visual syntax of these appropriated signs from Batman that Fahlström had also mixed with character signs of his own. To manipulate the world is to take responsibility for sense-making. Thanks to how complex our interactions with life, matter, space, and time have become, the philosopher Jean-Luc Nancy wrote 10 years ago, quote, "The sense of the word world is not only undecided and multiple, it has become the crucial point where all of the aspects and stakes of sense in general become tied together," unquote. To Nancy, then, in order to counter a technological loss of sense today, we must create new worlds, reopen each possible struggle for a world, and for what must form the contrary of a global injustice, he writes. Even though Brazil and Latin America in general figured strongly and repeatedly in Fahlström's work, especially in the 70s, for instance, with the case study of Venezuela in World Bank, and as here in Chile 1, another work we presented at the Sao Paulo Biennial, Fahlström never returned to his native country, nor did he ever exhibit there again in his lifetime after his participation in the 1954 Biennial. Fahlström's poetics of concretism carried with it an imperative of breaking down and reconstructing linguistic and cultural syntax. This was an imperative which was ultimately political, to confront and dismantle the mendacity of power and the conformity of habit in order to produce new models, expressions, and concepts. This message can be derived from his manifesto, which we also had translated to Portuguese for the exhibition. On this note, and by way of conclusion, I would like to quote Fahlström's close friend Peter Weiss, the German novelist and playwright who lived in Stockholm from 1940 to his death in 1982. And parenthetically, it was Peter Weiss's daughter Rebecca who was Fahlström's studio assistant when he was making Dr. Schweitzer's Last Mission. For one thing, Peter Weiss identified surrealism as what he called an actualization of Babylonic and Aztec figures. This is, of course, a characterization that is reminiscent of the Fahlström of the Adelie Dignander period. Also, Peter Weiss's social indignation and his fact-hogging descriptive style can be compared with the Fahlström of the 70s, who turned to a kind of history painting through the uncoded styles of comics and medieval tapestries and illustrations. With his magnum opus, Die Ästhetik des Widerstands, or The Aesthetics of Resistance, a book that he finished in 81, Peter Weiss offers a sea of words in support of the refusal to renounce resistance in the face of oppression. The novel is also a veritable compendium or even a museum of artworks that are brought to life as a trans-historical grammar of political action and social understanding. So somewhere in the first part of the book, Peter Weiss's protagonist says, and this is in my translation from the German, "And just as our political conviction was made up of fragments, dissonances, hypotheses, resolutions and slogans, supported by a conviction that came from our own life experiences, so too was art not to be included without its fluctuations, fractions, and contradictions. I hope this is an approximate translation from the German. As you can see, the English is quite a bit shorter than the German original, and in German it sounds a lot better, but that's the general drift. And I think that we can apply this as a kind of meta-commentary to Fahlström's concretism that first and last acknowledges that the world, or better, worlds in the plural, are always in the making, and that the subject or the agent of construction, the subject of knowledge and experience, is itself a world product, a patchworked result of symbolic orders of manipulation. So, manipulate the world. Do unto it what it does to you. Undo its dominance and recompose its totality. Play it. Thank you.